So we have with us this afternoon four such amazing women game changers. It's my pleasure to introduce them and welcome them on stage. Let me begin with a lady who sells a million pairs of fashionable socks every month, an entrepreneur and a fashion enthusiast who is today expanding the product range to include other apparel products like scarves, vests, and briefs for children. The co-founder at Mustang Socks since 2004, Lubina Shapurwala has been instrumental in making Mustang an aspirational brand in fashion apparel in India. At Mustang, Lubina and team have set the tone for an impressive growth rate and have tie-ups with some of the largest international brands, retailers, and e-tailers, including Amazon, FirstCry, and Hopscotch. Recently, she was recognized as the Entrepreneur of the Year in Manufacturing Business at the 5th Entrepreneur India Awards 2015. Please welcome Lubina. And let me take this opportunity to thank Nazneen, the founder of Mustang Socks, a strong and differently abled business leader, for joining us here today all the way from Mumbai. So Nazneen, if you can wave out. This is Nazneen, the founder of Mustang Socks. My second panelist is the lady whose business just got acquired by Magic Bricks. That was just last month. Priya Maheshwari is the co-founder and CEO of Propergy, India's leading pro-buyer real estate research analytics startups. And in less than 2 years, Priya and team have established Propergy as the go-to place for millions of home buyers to get honest, objective advice for their life's biggest financial decisions, which is investing in real estate. Priya holds a master's degree from University of Pennsylvania and has worked in the field of international business and management consultancy in the US and in India. Please welcome Priya Maheshwari. My third panelist is the brains behind a lifestyle portal that enjoys over 2 million Facebook fan interactions every single day. Priyanka Gill is the founder of PopExo.com. Combining her experience in lifestyle journalism with a flair for fashion, Priyanka created PopExo in 2014 as a digital content platform for engaging content lifestyle for young women in India. In 2015 alone, 1.2 billion people saw PopExo's posts on Facebook, and the website got over 19 million unique views. Priyanka has kept her brand ahead of the curve with initiatives such as the PopExo Style Council, the PopExo Blog Network, and the PopExo Campus Ambassador Program. Priyanka is also an investor in early stage tech and food startups, extends time and support to several charities, and is a mother of two. She's, of course, a much award-winning entrepreneur herself. So please welcome Priyanka Gill. And my fourth panelist today is the co-founder of the only venture capital-backed cashback site in India. Honored as one of the top 10 women entrepreneurs in India, Swati Bhargava is the co-founder of CashGaro.com, India's largest cashback and coupon site. Swati is an alumnus of the London School of Economics and started her business originally in the UK with her husband, Rohan. Swati has been instrumental in establishing cashback and affiliate marketing as one of the best performing marketing channels for retailers in India. She's also very, very popular on Twitter. So tweet away as we continue this conversation. Swati, welcome on stage. Lady Swati, great to have you here. Thank you so much for spending your Saturday afternoon. What does the idea of game changer mean to you? Sure. If you could just switch on your mic, just press the red button.
I think for me, the game changers is the person or the company who really understand the real pain point of a customer and who actually develops such a product or services for those customers that they really love it and they actually use it and love it and they pay for it. So I would say that those companies or those people who create such products for which customers fall in love.
Innovating.
Yes.
I think we've seen a game changer right here before us.
Absolutely. Yeah.
She, I am so in awe. I feel like after hearing Kalpana Ji's story, I feel like why are we here? Because she's obviously done so much. So for me, I think women who work with a sense of purpose, who have that spirit of challenge, to be able to do whatever comes their way and just go for it and just go for it. It's like she didn't give up. So I thought of other examples before coming here, and I was thinking of Kiran Majumdar Shaw, who's also kind of reminds me of that. But I think we don't need a better example than what we just saw.
Absolutely. Lubina? I think you might have a position.
Kiran Bedi, who we met this morning, a game changer. I think you have a dream, you have a belief, and you go for it. You don't cut corners. And you do what you do, you put in your best. And I think when you change things, you excel at, I think you excel at what you do first, and then if you want to change it, it just your belief drives you forward. You believe in what you do, you believe in the product. I make socks. I mean,
I make socks. Kids wear socks to school. I mean, you grew up looking at socks. It's just what you wore to school, playing white socks. And today, I'm trying to make it.
I believe that I could do it. I started this dream 15 years ago, and we're here today talking about it because we're featured as a fashion accessory, and that's my dream. I believed in it. I went for it. I didn't look here and there.
Thank you. Priyanka?
I think all of us are game changers in our own rights, right? We, no matter what you do, whether you're trying to raise children, whether you're trying to build your business, whether you're trying to found a startup, or no matter what you're doing. So I think a game changer is someone who really just does it, you know? Like, all of us have ideas, all of us have beliefs, we have dreams, we have hopes, and we have plans. And every time I meet people, say, I have this idea, I really wish and I pray for them that they just do it. I think that's what makes you a game changer. Not just sitting and just thinking about something, but just taking that first step and the second and the third and the fourth step and then just making it happen. And I think everyone can do that. And Kalpana Ji, as Swati said, did that with such stellar results and with such in the face of such adversity. Like, I was just sitting there and thinking, I complain about my problems. I really don't have problems. Like, problems are what she had, right? So just taking that step and going on in this room, that's what makes you a game changer.
Sure. We were not in this to change the game, actually. We were just doing what we believed in, you know. We just love what we do, I think, all of us. I love what I do. And we did it because we believed in it, we did it differently. I mean, the change came because we saw stagnation somewhere. And it just came to us from within. So we were not out to change it, it just happened. You know?
Change is just the way forward.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So tell me, what is the change, what's the biggest change that you've facilitated? You know, you're all here, you're all being called, game-changing women entrepreneurs. So what do you consider as the one big change that you've brought about in your industry?
Oh, you're looking at me very pointedly, so let me take that one.
All of us grew up reading magazines, right? That was a way that we all read. I mean, actually, we all grew up reading, right? I mean, I have two children, and they look at screens more than they look at anything else right now, but all of us grew up reading. My thing was, what do Indian girls read today? They clearly don't read magazines, right? You have like this device, this mobile phone. That's what Indian girls, or rather young India, that's all they have these days. So what do people read online was my question. And in startups, you talk a lot about disruption and what are you disrupting? And I guess for us, it was the printed word. And instead of reading magazines and newspapers, people read on mobile phones. And PopX was started to give Indian girls something to read. So we started about with fashion, and that wasn't enough. Fashion, beauty, sex, relationships, lots of boyfriends, lots of besties. And Piyush, everything this young girl wants to do today in life, we talk about it. And that was the space that we decided to kind of move on from the printed Femina, Cosmo, Vogue space, and then bring it onto the screen and into the digital space.
Lubina?
Yeah.
We started with making socks, which was just a necessity. In India, you got only nylon socks. I would say it worked in two phases for us. We moved from the nylon sock to cotton. So we made it a more comfortable piece of garment, an accessory. After which we brought in technology and made it even more comfortable by providing, say, handling toe, lycra. And then we said, okay, now we're all comfortable and cozy and everything. Where do we go now further? And we realized there's a huge market out there and we wanted to be out there. So we got fashion into the fashion health. So we have fashionable socks, we have socks that are sanitized, they're healthy. And socks as an industry is extremely unorganized. It's an unorganized trade. I would think even leather is unorganized today. Socks has machinery involved. It's a factory. So when I heard Kalpanaji talking, she had to pull her sleeves up literally and get into an industry and stand there and get things running. That's what we do. So we basically got an unorganized industry into an organized segment. And that's what changed. We partnered with people abroad. We partnered with our buyers abroad. And we brought a structure into the whole industry. And that's how we changed things around. We made it more accessible to the youth. We have 450 people working with us today. And we're looking at even teaching them what it means to wear, to make a sock and make it correctly in the organized way. There's more awareness now, and that's what we've done. So we've brought it from this scattered, unorganized business to something that's organized and moving like a machinery. And we're trying to set up more organized structures like that around us, yeah.
So when you say more accessible to the youth, just a quick question on how is that happening?
We have young students coming working with us, whether it's contests. So they are able to understand what we do. We have workshops at our end. We have NGOs that come and see what we do. And then we employ from there. So we want young people to understand that a sock was primarily sold by the larger stores as, all right, we're selling garments and we have a bit of a budget left and we put socks into the little corner, into a corner there, you know. But now people actually are looking at creating themes around socks, storyboards, just as you have for intimate wear, lingerie.
Yes.
Yeah, so if they can do it for that, I can do it for socks.
Awesome. Yeah. Swati, what would you say about your journey in creating change, or changing the game?
So
for Rohan, my husband and I, both of us run the business together. We always wanted to do something in the field of online and e-commerce. So I'm actually from Ambala. I grew up in a small town. Then I studied in London at London School of Economics, got a scholarship there, worked at Goldman Sachs for 5 years. And then it was all about what is it next, right? I want to do something, but I wasn't sure of what. And that's when Rohan and I came across the idea of cashback. And when we looked at India, we thought, you know, this market is perfect for a money-saving product because everybody in India likes to save money. E-commerce is growing, online shopping is happening. So we felt that there was room for disruption in the space of online savings because people were looking for coupons and it was all over different websites on the web. A coupon kahin hai, kahin pe hai. Nothing was like consolidated properly. And we wanted to make the savings richer, not just limited to coupons. So we actually tied up with all the top e-commerce players. So we work with about 1,000 websites, which includes everyone from Snapdeal, Flipkart, Paytm, to across different categories like Yatra, Make My Trip. And what we do is that we actually give users cash back on whatever you buy online. So as long as you go to, say, Flipkart via Cash Karo and buy, you'll get cash back from us, which is paid from the commission that we are getting from these retailers. And it can be paid to your bank account as real cash. So the game-changing aspect here was how to make the Indian consumer be able to save more money and how to do it in a way that is very simple for people to do. So all that users need to do is just visit via Cash Karo. And then in order to take it one level up, we actually integrated a module of price comparison and product discovery on Cash Karo as well. So that it becomes like a savings destination. So that you come to one place and you can show that there is potential for this kind of product in India. That is Reena Jerry. you. And Priya?
So we started Propelgy in August of 2013, and the vision was like, we wanted to bring trust, transparency and professionalism in the real estate sector. So then in order to do that, in the last two years, two game changers things we did in our journey of Propelgy. First was we built a pro buyer real estate research analytics platform, which can be scaled to the pan India with a very lean team. And then second we did is we developed an algorithm based scoring methodology with which you can score builders, developers and localities. And the whole purpose was doing that is we wanted to give customer an objective and analytical way of comparing the projects and making them decide which property they should invest or which property they should buy, and like giving them an informed giving them a power to make an informed decision. So that was the whole thing. So then we thought that this scoring methodology would be well received by the customers, and to our surprise and we thought that the builders would take it in a very resistant manner. They would not like it. But then to our surprise, few of the builders actually called me and they asked me, like, I wanted to know what your scoring algorithm methodology is. How do you score a project 8 out of 10 and not 6 out of 10? It was like more the whole purpose of building this transparency. It was coming. The builder wanted to share more information. They wanted to like tell more about them about their projects or like what kind of areas they are going in. So then we had this old entire tech based pro buyer research analytics platform, and the area which we were lacking were the data, because there is no such data in India for the real estate. So the magic last year Magicbricks approached us and they said that we like your pro buyer analytics platform, which we were doing in Bangalore. We did it for 100 projects in Bangalore, and they said like we will do a pilot with you. So we did a pilot with them for 6 months, and they really liked our team, they really liked our technology platform, and then they said let's work together. And so this year March they acquired us, and it was a win-win situation for both of us, because we wanted a data. Magicbricks is the number one listing site. They started in 2006, so we wanted that data, and they wanted that technology platform. So yeah, I mean, building a technology based research analytics platform and the scoring methodology was a game changer for us.
Okay. So what's fascinating about the panel this afternoon is that we've got a cross-section of industries here. We've got fashion, we've got content, we've got manufacturing, e-commerce, real estate. All of them women co-founders at the top. One question I have to you is, and we've kind of touched upon some of this in the morning, but what was the challenge in becoming a woman game changer, or in being a woman game changer? What are some of the challenges that you witness on a day-to-day basis? And you've got 2 minutes each. Just in the interest of time.
Whoever actually keeps looking at you know that you have to start off it. So I think it's me this time. So in my field, I've actually been one of the few women always. So even when I was at Goldman Sachs, it's an investment banking industry and very few women are there. So I was the only female in my team of 10 male people. So I got used to that idea of going out for a beer on Friday with them. I wasn't interested in soccer, so I didn't pretend that I would be. But sometimes, you do sport together as well. And now in the field of technology and e-commerce, again, it's a very thin layer of women that are there, especially at the top. Challenges, I think we've all faced challenges, and for me in particular, I don't think I've faced anything which was only because I'm a woman. I think the challenges I've faced actually have been the same, even if it was a male counterpart in my place. And I think part of the reason for that is that I don't ever let gender come in my mind. It's business, and therefore every decision has to be made keeping in mind what is good for the business. Because I think a lot of challenges that women face, not all, but sometimes it's in our mind. And I think we have to stop hesitating and stop thinking that it's a challenge and certain things we can't do or can do because we're a woman. So obviously, so those things I've never let bother me. You know, sometimes there are stereotypes, obviously, when I go for meetings with Rohan, sometimes people will say, so what technology is your website based on? And they kind of look at Rohan directly. They kind of assume that he should know what technology it's on and not me. And I think that's the stereotype that people think that, but if they want to know that, you know, so how is your social media? They'll just look at me first. So I mean, like, how? It could be other way as well. How do you know? You have to look here. But I think that that's the stereotyping, right? People have that. But I have no problem saying that as a woman, I am very happy to go out there, put myself out there and prove that these stereotypes do not apply. And I think sometimes when we make that mark, and sometimes if I comment or participate actively in technology discussions or in other things, people suddenly change their perspective and they kind of get a reality check that, oh, okay, let me not assume she doesn't know. So sometimes I think women need to do that. You know, if we need to put men in their place sometimes, it's okay. I don't take offense to that.
Yeah, be a bit more vocal about your knowledge.
Yeah, and I think, you know, actually, it's not a bad idea to make sure that you are technologically sound. Sometimes women also say, I mean, sometimes between me and Rohan also, I know that my skill set is better actually in social media or in marketing, but I have made a conscious effort to make sure that I am equally up to date with the technology stuff as well, so that, because I don't want to be boxed in that stereotype. So for that, we have to make effort and I don't mind doing it.
Sure. Rubina?
I pretty much echo what Swati said. The thing is, it's perception. It's just perception, changing people's perceptions of us more than anything. Whether it's the market, whether it's at your workplace, being a woman, standing in a factory, we have visitors, we have people from all over coming. And I went through something very similar to Swati went through. We were on a factory round and we had a delegation of people coming in and they were asking questions about the machinery. And the questions would all be aimed at the males in the group. And I said, hello. And I would, even though I would be giving out replies, they would be making eye contact with the men most of the times. And it's changed. So it's basically the perception that you have to change for people out there. They're not used to seeing certain things and that's what we need to change. I don't think being a woman, like Swati said, is something that really came in the way, because if it's not in your mind that you're a woman, and that's not on, I mean, you make a big deal of it if it's a big deal in your head there. That was never in my head that I'm a woman and I'm doing this and this is going to be a problem for us. For us, I think it was just the task that was ahead of us, and it was how to get the best out of what we wanted to get done, and we just didn't take no for an answer. We refused to take no for an answer at any point in time, whether it was the machinery guy saying ye nahi banega, whether it was the Korean technician who said 3D socks, who does 3D socks, and he said nahi banega, ho payega, let's do this. We didn't take no for an answer. Whether it was Nazneen founded the company by going, I love telling this story. Nazneen founded the company by going on a bike into the slums and carrying the yarn on her backpack and going into the slums, getting the socks made and carrying those same socks back on her backpack and selling it out there in the market. And she would pack it herself. And this was 30 years ago when the company started. And 30 years ago, it was Krishnaji and her packing, and then Krishnaji is still in the factory and he still heads the packing department. And I still go and ask him, how do you pack these socks if we have something new? But my point is, she didn't let anything get in the way. And we have 250 women who work with us and they don't let anything get in their way. And the message goes all the way down there to them as well. So that's the only thing. Being a woman facing challenges because you're a woman, it's all in your mind.
Thank you. Priyanka? You know, beginning of the year, you have Women's Day and then you have Mother's Day, and I think there aren't that many female founders around, so then you constantly get asked this question. So as a female founder, what happens? I'm like, I don't think her life is any different from a male founder.
our challenges are exactly the same. You have exactly the same crosses to bear. You have exactly the same points to prove. And I don't think any investor gives you money because you're male or female. An investor will give you money because your idea is sound and you have a plan and you're going to do well. So I think that is the question itself, the fact that we have to face that all the time, and that fact that we are made to answer that. Obviously, it says something. And equally, the fact that we are all sitting here and we all are female founders of successful companies, and that's also, that's an answer back to that. So I think your question was, what challenges do you face as a female founder?
Yes.
As a founder, I face many. As a female founder, I don't think I face any challenges that are different from the first list. I have a few, obviously instances happen to you that are quite funny. I remember in one of my first pitches, we were making a pitch, and someone happened to Google what my husband does. And they go, oh, why doesn't your husband fund you? I'm like, listen, this is my company, it's my thing. I mean, that's such a rude question. And I've had that, and we laughed it off, and we walked off, and they offered us money, we didn't take that. My co-founder, her husband also works in the company, and we've had people who had issues with that. How can the husband and wife work together? And I think that's a very sexist thing to say, and it's all kinds of things get said. So no, I think the best thing is you do your work, you do it really well, you make it a success, and then everyone who's been questioning you or who's been asking you questions, they will just stop. And yeah, that's the best answer.
Priya, what do you have to say to that question?
I think the real estate is like, it's a male dominated, like, I mean, when I started this, I moved from US, and I was working as an infrastructure consulting in an infrastructure consulting firm in US in San Francisco. And then the things were totally, when I used to go out in a meetings, meeting builders or maybe meeting the government agencies, sometimes I used to be like single woman. I know all of us has faced that. I used to go with my other co-founder who's a male, and then they used to answer him instead of me. And I have like that strong research analytics background, and I used to ask them the question, then I was always thinking, why are they not replying to me? So I mean, it took me a lot of time to build that credibility. But I think it was more like believing in yourself or believing in myself that took me, that I really want to like solve that real pain point of a customer in buying that property or in taking that informed decision, that let me go every day. So.
Thank you.
I have something to say.
Yes.
Very often I get in meetings, अच्छा तो company आपके पिताजी की होगी, तो आपके पति की होगी, ऐसे नहीं जी. So this is what we get.
In manufacturing especially, you get that. Oh no, mine was worse actually. So we raised a Series A round, and the Economic Times ran a story. So I did the whole interview with a girl, and at the end of the interview, she goes to me, so you're married? I'm like, yes. What does your husband do? I'm like, he's a trader. And then I just left it at that. So the next day, the article comes out, and suddenly it's whatever. Popexa raised $2 million, and these are the funds that they raised it from. And at the end it goes, oh, Priyanka Gill's husband is a trader. I'm like, what relevance does that have to the entire story? He does nothing with the company. So, I mean, all these things, and she was a female a journalist. So all these things that we all do, and we all kind of, it just comes by the way and acceptable. I think it's absolutely not. So, I mean, PopExo had one male employee and 40 female employees for the longest time. I think till we hired the tech team, we got another 8 more men in the company. Today we are 65, and we are still a female-led company. Obviously, both the founders are female, and all the employees are majority female as well. So, I mean, I think diversity is something that you build. And I think all of us as founders, that's what we all push this agenda for women, and I think that's a good thing.
So if you look around the room, are women who are probably just out of college, maybe sort of mid-career, and then you have women who are in their later phases of the careers as well. Does becoming a game changer stop with younger women, or is it also for women in the later parts of their careers?
I think you're coming
and
into trouble with this question.
Different. Yeah,
you got to define young and old for us.
Well, okay, first 10 years of your career as opposed to
let's say the first decade of your career as opposed to the third decade of your career.
So she's saying basically if you're in your 20s, you're young, and if you're in your 30s, you're old?
No, I didn't say young or old. I talked about different phases of the career.
Cool. I'll take that actually. Times again, they made my age public knowledge. I started the company when I was 33 years old, and obviously I'm 35 now. So I don't know, in the startups discussion, that makes me an old founder, because typically most founders are in the early 20s or they're just in the first jobs or whatever. I like to believe that the fact that I've had a decade or of experiences and all kinds of commercial things behind me has made me a better founder now, because I understand a lot more of people, relationships, reality, lawyers, accountants. So I don't think that matters actually. Anytime, I mean, there's this is lovely thing, this whole that goes around about all the people who did great things and who are in the 40s. So I think age is a number. You just have to be able to put in the hours and the time and all that. And often with family, and in my case with two kids, I mean, everything just becomes a major struggle to just kind of fit everything into your time. I think if you're young and single and no kids, life might be slightly easier. But apart from that, I don't think it really matters.
So let me rephrase that question a bit. Are the challenges different? I mean, we'll move on to the other panelists to address. Are the challenges different, and how do you address those?
The challenges are the same, I think. It's just age is a number, like you said, but and also it's just how open your mind is. Just keep an open mind. I mean, I have a co-founder who founded the company actually 30 years ago, Nazneen. She's in the audience. I mean, we are now selling socks online. We are doing interesting stuff, which she never dreamt we would do. But the fact that she supports all our madness, and she has an open mind. I mean, she's conquered mountains, and now she's conquering socks with us all over the world. You know, she was a mountaineer before. So it's just an open mind. There's nothing beyond that. Just keep your mind open. Age is a number, and you can achieve what you want to. It's really simple.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think there's enough said on that. I actually think that I've seen this in my mom as well. All our life, she's been a homemaker. And suddenly, 3 years ago, she said, you know, I'm actually starting a business. I said, acha, so what? And she's making these beautiful wedding accessories because she's always been into social service. So she's got a team with her of 10 women. They make beautiful wedding bags. And, you know, my sister Angie, she's a makeup artist. And now my mom is actually advising her on different things, and I think I actually see a different side of her, because I think sometimes, in fact, women come through that curve when they know that, you know, their family's okay, their kids are taken care of, and they think, you know, actually it's my time now. And first time when she told us that I've got a business, most of us were a little surprised because we never expected it. You kind of think that if you're a little old, would you start a business? But actually, when you see them and you see that she works with the same passion, with the same everything, that when I look at her, I'm like, okay, actually, that's where I got it from. And so if we are entrepreneurs, I think our parents actually, you know, have it in them. We've kind of got those genes from there. So absolutely, age is just a number, yeah.
Priya, would you like to add to that?
Yeah, just one line. I think at the end of the day, it's just the passion which matters. Age does not matter. And Priyanka, I'm older than you. Okay. So I have also a daughter, a 6 years old daughter.
Wow.
So it's like... it's like we have to, I mean, as we grow up in our journey, like in professional journey, our priorities do change. Like when you are a single woman, you have a lot of time. When you are like, you have a wife, when you're married with kids, you have other priorities also to take care. But I mean, it's all up to you. It all depends on you. It's just at the end of the day, it's just the passion. You need to have that passion. The time will come out automatically.
I would like to ask a question that I request you to answer in one sentence, if you can. What is the one biggest personal learning on your journey to being an innovative business leader? The biggest personal learning.
The harder I work, the luckier I get.
Okay. That's a good one. Who's got one? Who's next?
Okay, I'll take it. Don't take no for an answer.
Yeah, sorry. The mic wasn't on.
Sorry. Don't take no for an answer. No matter what, just don't take no. I mean, I think as long as you do that, you succeed.
Thank you.
I think just have an I can do an attitude. It's like just in a journey, you will face a lot of ups and downs. So you have to find a solution to a problem in whichever you can. So just think, I can do it. So,
Rubina?
Believe in yourself. Don't doubt. If you have a dream, just go out there and get it. Just believe in yourself. Yeah, pretty much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. With that, we'll open up for questions from the audience. We have about 5 minutes. Ma'am, you're the most enthusiastic member of the audience today. I'll have to give that to you. Can we begin with anyone else? I will come. I will accept your question. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am. Just press the red button.
Okay. I know all of you said that there is really no difference between a man, if he was a co-founder, than you. But then in your comments, you did say, you know, you're a mother, you're, you know, whatever else, you're challenging, you're all these different things. So I think, let's be a little bit more honest here. I think for women, when they become co-founders or co-founders or whatever they do, they bring certain elements that add to the space, but there are also some specific female challenges. So can we get a little bit more honest on that?
Who would like to answer that? Just answer that.
Actually, I don't think in the working of it there is a challenge. I see more of a challenge in how people perceive us. When I'm sitting in the factory and doing what I do, and resolving things or making a design, I don't see a challenge there because it's my work that speaks. But when I'm out there and I see the way people are viewing me or perceiving me as a woman, I feel that is more of a challenge. And for us to break that ceiling that you're a woman and bring this particular work or particular job is, I think that's more of a challenge for us to handle. For me at least, yeah.
I have one more as well. I think for women, sometimes it's harder to figure out the exact tone. What is the tone of you, of your management style? Because if I am too aggressive, then I'm a bitch. But if I'm too soft, then she's not capable enough to be a leader. So I think it's important to find that tone while not losing your personality. Because generally, I am more relaxed than my husband, but that doesn't mean that I am not as good a leader or I have to shout to prove my point. So I think women have a little bit more of that balancing act to do than men do.
I think the final thing is time, you know, the juggling for women just seems more onerous, and which is true. Like, for example, take a typical husband-wife couple who work. I would... Like maybe it's not a good thing to think, but maybe she's the one who's actually more involved with, say, the childcare or the house running or whatever, and she's expected to do the equal amount of work as well. So I think time is just more challenging for women. I mean, I've been blessed with a very, very supportive husband, but I think of the two of us, I will know at every given point and moment of my kids' life where they are, what they're doing, while he'll have a broader idea. So I think just as a time management, and I mean, it's a challenge, and it's fun as well, but I think it's purely that. It's just managing your time better.
Sorry, I think we women are far more capable at multitasking than men, so we have a lot more.
So we've got a lot more, but we've got the skills to handle a lot more as well. Let's take your question, ma'am. I think that will be the last question for the panel.
Before I ask my question, I would like to announce my name so that my name is Anushka Suri. I've come here as a learner. My question is that what are the barriers to adoption of technology which you feel are present in India from the perspective of consumers? I've heard your views from your technology perspective from an organization point of view, but from the point of view of consumer, since you are running a technology savvy venture, so what challenges do you see that consumers find difficult to adopt to new technology? Is the question clear?
Yeah, I think if you're looking at India specifically, the biggest challenge that all of us face is that it's the two things actually. One is connectivity. So in terms of how accessible the internet is to people. Second thing is just access to devices, you know. People, enough of India doesn't have access to devices. I mean, even take a step further, electricity for that matter, right? So I think when, especially that's true in what I do. So we get 3 million monthly unique visitors, of which 90% are female. For my number to grow, I need more women to come online. How do more women come online? More of them come online if they have access to a device. The first device in most middle class or lower middle class households would go to the father or to the brother. So women don't have access to devices, right? So it's basic infrastructure problems that are actually stopping, more so than a personal bias towards not adopting technology or things like that. So in my business, for sure, it's a fact that enough women aren't online. So the challenge is, how do you get more women online?
Okay, Kemi, I think we'll take one last question and then we'll wrap with that.
Thank you for that. So I have a startup of my own, and I just wanted to know if any of the panelists are available to be mentors for me, please. So that's my question. And by the way, Priyanka, we are bus buddies from NSR Times.
Absolutely. I mean, talk to us afterwards, I think. And I speak for all of us.
Sure.
Beautiful. Thank you.
Approach them offline. Thank you so much. May I request all the panelists to please step forward onto the stage. You have just go to either side. And I'll request the lovely volunteers to please step forward and present the speakers with mementos.